The name of this video is Electrostatic Shield Differential. In the previous video, we studied electrostatic shields by means of the integral form of Maxwell's equations for the electrostatic field. In this case, we want to use the differential form. We consider again a hollow conductor in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium within a cavity, capital omega. The conductor itself occupies a region of space which we call capital gamma. The external surface is capital sigma external. The internal surface, capital sigma internal, respectively. Suppose to call any point on capital sigma internal as capital Q. The reason why I call them Q instead of P is because they actually is where we want to investigate whether there is a charge distribution small sigma or not. So it's a sort of charge if there is. We already know empirically and from the integral form that actually there cannot be any charge there, but that's why I call them Q. So in any neighborhood of any point Q on capital sigma internal, there is a small area, dA, and the normal unit vector, in this case, points into the vacuum region, which is the inner vacuum here. So n points in this direction. And as always, we hypothesize that we inject a certain charge, small q, let's say positive or negative, it doesn't matter, on the other surface, capital sigma external of this conductor with a hollow cavity. Again, we already know from empirical evidence and the integral form of Maxwell's equations that this Q can only distribute itself on capital sigma external. Now we want to use the differential form of Maxwell's equations and the definition of electrostatic potential to show that actually this charge, again, does only distribute on capital sigma external. So it's another way to prove it, more mathematical than the previous version. All right, so with that definitions in mind here, a generic point P here, that's what we call it, capital P. So we want to basically set a Dirichlet problem to find the electrostatic potential everywhere in space. So how do we do that? Well, instead of setting up an external Dirichlet problem, in this case, we are looking at this region of space, which is somehow around the inner cavity, and n point inward into the inner cavity. So this is called the internal Dirichlet problem. Which comprises three steps, so three equations if you want, three conditions. As always, we first focus on the vacuum region in capital omega. There, since we are in vacuum, we have to fulfill Laplace equation, homogeneous equation. So we know that Laplace equation, the scalar Laplacian of V, the electrostatic potential at any point P is equal to zero for each point capital P in capital omega. So this capital P can be either there or in omega. This also we call it capital P. Only those points on capital sigma internal, we call them capital Q. Where there could be, as again, we know that there isn't, there could be a distribution of small sigma, which is what we want to prove that is equal to zero. Okay? So again, we want to prove that there is no charge distribution small sigma at any point Q, we want to prove that this is equal to zero. So that's what we want to prove, okay? For any point Q. Okay, so this is the first step of the internal Dirichlet problem. Of course, we don't have normal conditions at infinity because we are considering a space which is confined. So the other condition is that at the boundary, so we want that the electrostatic potential V at any point capital Q is equal to zero. Now, by definition, I will restress it here. This means for each point capital Q on capital sigma interna, but that's the very definition of point capital Q. But I'm stressing it here to make sure we are on the same page. Lastly, the electrostatic potential, no matter what inner or outer Dirichlet problem, internal or external, it has to be a continuous function. So B, for any point P, which could be a Q point, again, I'm just stressing this only for the boundary itself. So at any point P or Q, it has to be a continuous function. So it has to be a continuous function anywhere in capital omega union the frontier, the boundary, capital sigma internal. And again, here, just to be precise, at point we call it Q, but it's the same, I call it P, it's the same thing. And union, gamma, and of course this has to be true actually anywhere else, so it's outside to infinite. But we are really interested in the conductor, so because it's an inner problem, so let's stop there. So these are the conditions which have to be fulfilled for an internal Dirichlet problem, where n is defined in this fashion. Great. So now we know that if a function such as v fulfills the Laplace equation from vector calculus, at least you should know that this is called a harmonic function. See vector calculus. So v of p has to be harmonic function, also very important in definition of capacitance, because harmonic functions has very important properties, including the concept of capacitance is built in into harmonic functions. So since the harmonic functions, just because again it fulfills Laplace equation as spelled out here mathematically, well, in this case, what we want to do next is we want to use properties of harmonic functions. An important property is the so-called first Green's identity. So according to the first Green's identity, first Green in brief, we know that, let me first spell it out here in yellow, the generic one, for any set of functions, for any pair of functions f and g. So for any pair of functions f and g, it turns out that the flux through any closed surface, capital sigma, whatever that surface is, of f, which is a generic function, as long as it is harmonic function, f is harmonic, and also g, which I'm about to introduce, is also harmonic. So then we take the directional derivative, that is the gradient of g, dotted on n dA, and defined for an internal Dirichlet problem in this fashion. This integral, this flux, has to be equal to the volume integral, that's what the identity tells us. So we go from the frontier to the inner volume of the gradient of f, dotted with the gradient of g. This, we need to integrate over dv, and summed up with the volume integral in capital omega of f times the scalar Laplacian of g, dv. This is Green's first identity, again, which is a property of harmonic functions. Now, suppose that we set f, a special case of this pair of functions f and g, we set f to be equal to g to be equal to v, our electrostatic potential. So in that case, this identity reads the flux through capital sigma, let's write it for this problem, an internal Dirichlet problem, so through sigma internal, which is this surface here, f becomes nothing but v. This v times the gradient of v projected along n, definition of flux. This has to be equal to the volume integral in the inner cavity, capital omega, of the gradient of v times dotted scalar product, the gradient of v again. So this is the norm of the gradient of v quantity squared dv. Now, before I continue, let me ask two questions that I want you to discuss in piazza. The first question is this the same kind of flux we calculate in Coulomb's theorem? So this is the first question, P piazza one. Is this as in Coulomb's theorem? Think about that, very important. The second question which I have for you in piazza, has this quantity anything to do with the Laplacian, the scalar Laplacian? I know that both these concepts create lots of confusion. I'm not gonna tell you here, I just wanted to discuss, and I will just give you the proof here. All right, I'm already using this concept which I'm asking here in the following proof. All right, so this is not the whole story, because we also need to add here the last term, which is the volume integral in capital omega of F, which is capital V, the electrostatic potential, times, in this case, this one is the scalar Laplacian of V dV. And again, do not confuse this V where I explicitly put these two dashes with dV, which is the volume element, okay? This is electrostatic potential, this is a volume element. You can call it tau, whatever you want to call it. As length, I think in other videos I call it dr cube. For simplicity here, let me just call it V, but one time only, let me just say that this is equivalent to a dr cube, if you want, nothing to do with this V, okay? So we want to calculate this first integral, which is a flux, through the external, through the internal surface, capital sigma internal, right on the surface, that is at each point on the surface. So in this case, we know that each point on the surface, capital sigma internal, V of capital Q has to be equal to zero. Let's generalize it to a more generic V naught. That is, of course, it could be zero. We can choose pretty much any value you want of the electrostatic potential in this case, but let me generalize it from zero to a generic value V naught for generality. So in that case, we know that at each point right on this surface capital sigma internal, capital V is V naught, a constant. The gradient of capital V, which is a constant, is the gradient, the derivative of a constant. This obviously has to be equal to zero. Therefore, the entire integral is equal to zero. And again, I know that people, again, have lots of problems with this part of the proof, because in a previous video we discussed a lot about Coulomb's theorem, where we have a similar integral with a similar, except for this V, gradient of V dot MVA, which is a directional derivative. But in that case, remember in which condition it was? Again, think about this in Piazza. All right, so now let's look at the right-hand side of this equation. So for example, let's look at this last term here. So this last term is a volume integral in capital omega, which means we are in this region here. In this region, we have V times the scalar Laplacian of V, but the scalar Laplacian of V at any point capital P in the region capital omega has to be equal to zero, because of course we are in a vacuum. And therefore, this whole integral is equal to zero. Thus, we are left only with this integral here, which has to be equal to zero. Okay, so now let's consider this term here. This term, which is the volume integral in capital omega of the norm square of gradient of V, has to be equal to zero, because this term is also equal to zero. So let's look at this integral. In order to be zero, the integrand has to be zero. In particular of the integrand, the gradient of V has to be equal to zero. That's sufficient to give, as a result, zero. So let's write down this down here mathematically. So we know that the gradient of V has to be equal to zero, where at any point capital P in the inner cavity capital omega. This implies that the electrostatic potential V has to be equal to a constant for each point in capital omega. Why is that? Because, of course, the gradient of a constant is equal to zero. But let's look at these conditions here. We know that V has to be a continuous function in both these regions, the volumes, capital omega, the inner cavity, and the conductor itself, capital gamma, as well as on the boundary, the frontier, which is capital sigma internal. All right, so this means that this constant has to be as such not only in capital omega, but also union capital sigma internal, union capital gamma. And in fact, this has to be the case. In particular, let's focus for a minute on this last part here, which is in capital gamma. Why V has to be constant in capital gamma? Well, we know that the electrostatic field E within capital gamma in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium has to be zero at each point capital P in capital gamma, okay? So the electrostatic field is zero, it means the electrostatic potential has to be constant there. That's why we can say that. So this comes from the macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium condition, okay? All right, so if this is true, let's look at this other condition here. We know that V, at any point on the surface capital sigma internal, has to be equal to V naught, which means this constant can't be any generic constant. It has to be exactly this constant V naught. And so the result of this first green identity is that V has to be a constant, a particular constant, V naught, at each point in the inner cavity, all the capital omega, all the way to the surface capital sigma internal, and eventually at every point in capital gamma, because of the macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium conditions, in capital gamma is equal to zero. Okay, we discussed about that. So this is the condition we obtain here. This means that we know the electrostatic field in general is given by minus the gradient of the electrostatic potential in all these three regions, capital omega, capital sigma n, and capital gamma. V is constant. That is, in all these regions, E has to be equal to zero. In particular, E has to be zero in the neighborhood of any point capital Q on capital sigma interno. That is, if I pick one of these points here, capital Q, in any neighborhood here, it has to be true that E is equal to zero. In particular, if I project E along the normal direction N in this internal Dirichlet problem, that normal direction of E has to be ought En, the normal component of E ought has to be equal to zero. So now we can finally invoke Coulomb's theorem, which in this case is a limiting theorem. So we want to write down the limit for any point capital P in the internal Dirichlet problem that approaches any point capital Q from the minus side, so I'm approaching from inside this point capital Q of E projected along N, which is the normal component of E, which we just said has to be equal to zero. This quantity, again, has to be equal to zero. But this we know from Coulomb's theorem that has to be nothing but small sigma at any point capital Q divided by epsilon naught. As a consequence, this proves that small sigma capital Q has to be equal to zero for each point capital Q on capital sigma internal, which is exactly what we wanted to prove. So this, by means of the first green identity, allows us to tell mathematically one more time, even more precisely than with the integral form of Maxwell's equations for the electrostatic field, that the surface charge distribution small sigma capital Q is equal to zero for each point on capital Q on capital sigma internal, even when we apply a charge no Q on the external surface capital sigma external. So if there is a charge, this charge has to distribute itself only on capital sigma external. Nothing will go on capital sigma internal. Now, let me ask you a question which I want you to discuss in Piazza. So this is Piazza question number 3. So what happens if, two possible scenarios, instead of placing a charge right on the surface, we place a charge distribution, let's say, somewhere here, Q prime, away from the conductor itself. Or, alternatively, instead of having a charge distribution, we immerse this object, this conducting object, in an external electrostatic field generated by some unknown charge distribution somewhere in space, Ex for external. So what happens in these two cases to the inner cavity here? So if we place ourselves in this inner cavity capital omega, do we know that there was a charge Q prime somewhere way outside the conductor gamma? Do we know that there was an external field Ex? Yes or no? That is the question, which of course is related to this proof. And so the question is double. So first, what happens if I have Q prime? And second, what happens if I have an external field Ex? All right, so to summarize this video, we consider a conducting hollow object, a capital gamma, in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium with an inner cavity capital omega, bounded by an interface capital sigma internal. We set up an internal Dirichlet problem where small n point inwards internal with respect to any point capital Q on capital sigma internal. This is the internal Dirichlet problem, only three conditions. The first one is that the Laplacian inside vacuum, of course, has to be equal to zero, so Laplace equation. This means that the electrostatic potential has to be a harmonic function, so we can use Green's identities, for example, the first one, which is written here mathematically. When we choose for the pair of function Fg of the first Green identity, f equal g equal v, which is the electrostatic potential, which is also a harmonic function, obviously. So we can do that. we obtain this new set of equations here, this new equation with three terms. And so the first is a flux, the other two are volume integrals. I ask you a couple of questions. And again, the first question is about the fact that the flux is right at each point, right on the surface, capital T internal. So compare these to Coulomb's theorem, what are the differences? The second question was about this norm of the gradient of V square. What is the relationship with Laplace, if there is any? And finally, we impose this internal degree problem to this equation here. And therefore, these two terms go to zero. So this term has to be equal to zero. The only way to do that is that the integrand, therefore, the gradient of V is equal to zero. So then we show that obviously V has to be constant in that case. But it has to be a specific constant because of the continuity of V. It has to be the constant V naught. Because of that, we know the definition of E is equal to minus gradient of V, which again in this region also has to be equal to zero. And again, the fact that we are in ME also means that E is equal to zero inside gamma. So the fact that this is true, both these equations are true also here inside gamma, is due to the ME condition. Let me stress this one more time. And so this eventually allows us to tell that the electrostatic field in any neighborhood of any point capital Q and capital sigma internal has to be equal to zero. So since it's true in any neighborhood, we can use Coulomb's theorem in this fashion, which eventually tells us that if there was a sigma on capital sigma internal, a small sigma, has to be zero everywhere in space. And so eventually, intuitively, qualitatively, what we have proven is that it's not possible to have a certain charge distribution, let's say positive here, a negative there, which sums up to zero, but it would lead to an electrostatic field in this direction, which would be different than zero inside capital omega. This cannot be, okay? So what this tells us, it just tells us this phenomenon cannot be. Because again, the key is that the electrostatic field is zero within omega, which is all built in this equation. So there cannot be a field E equals zero in there, okay? So that cannot be the case. So this cannot be. And in fact, this is quite important. And again, I really want you to think about that because sometimes the students have an issue with this condition here. So V a capital Q has to be equal to V naught. It seems to some people that this is sufficient to state that sigma is equal to zero. And if you start to look here, oh, you see V is equal to V naught. But we already said V is equal to V naught. Yeah, we said that V is equal to V naught where? In the points of capital sigma internal, but not in the points of capital omega. In order to show that in capital omega, the field is zero, and so the gradient of V is equal to zero, you cannot just rely on this condition here, which is a boundary condition. You really need the first identity, which eventually leads to Coulomb's theorem in this fashion. So that's the key element of this proof. So the capital omega, not only just capital sigma, you need that kind of concept qualitatively, which was what I explained here. And so in this sense, if I have a conducting material with a hollow cavity, from outside, it doesn't matter even if there is a hollow cavity. For us, we can fill it up completely, or we can leave it with a hollow cavity. It behaves effectively as if it were exactly the same object from outside. We don't care. We don't know. We have no knowledge of what's happening inside. And similarly, inside, we don't have knowledge of what's happening outside. We'll come back to this concept later. And so with this, we conclude this video. That's it.